It's August 1922, and Albert Einstein is writing a letter to his younger sister, Maja. With anti-Semitism on the rise in Germany, the scientist has fled his home in Berlin. And spelling out his fears for the future of his nation, he comes up with a grim prediction that will play out with startling accuracy over the following years. Einstein was born on March 14, 1879 in Ulm, a city in what was then known as the German Empire. When he was still a baby, his parents, Hermann and Pauline, moved 100 miles east to Munich. Here, Hermann and his brother founded a company specializing in electrical engineering. Although Hermann and Pauline were both Ashkenazi Jews, they did not practice their religion, and so at the age of 5, Einstein began attending a Catholic school. 3 years later, he moved to Munich's Luitpold Gymnasium, where it became clear he had a talent for physics and math. At just 12 years old, Einstein was teaching himself advanced mathematics, swiftly getting to grips with systems like Euclidean geometry, and soon his intellect had surpassed that of his tutor. Unfazed, he continued to learn calculus by himself, claiming to have become proficient in it by the age of 14. At 13, Einstein discovered the German philosopher Immanuel Kant. By this time, he believed that mathematics could be used as a tool for understanding the world, and he devoured the notoriously complex Critique of Pure Reason with enthusiasm. At 17, he enrolled at Zurich Polytechnic in Switzerland after disavowing his German citizenship to escape serving in the military. In Zurich, Einstein spent 4 years studying physics and mathematics before graduating in 1900. Unable to secure a teaching job, however, he then took a position at the patent office in Bern, Switzerland. That same year, his first paper was published in Annalen der Physik, a prestigious scientific journal. From then on, Einstein's career as a scientist went from strength to strength. In 1905 alone, he earned his PhD from Zurich University and published 4 separate papers that changed our understanding of physics for good. Among them were his first published thoughts on special relativity, the theory that would become his most famous work. In 1908, Einstein was offered a lecturing job at the University of Bern. After 3 years there, he took a position at the Charles Ferdinand University in Prague, then part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. There, he continued to produce work prolifically, eventually returning to Zurich to work as a professor of theoretical physics. In 1914, Einstein accepted a position back in the German Empire as a professor at Berlin's Prussian Academy of Sciences. By that time, he was embroiled in an affair with his first cousin, Elsa. The temptation to live closer to her likely affected his decision to move to Berlin, even though he'd already been married to Mileva Maric, a mathematician from Serbia, for 10 years. Einstein was tipped to become director at the new Kaiser Wilhelm Institute for Physics. However, the outbreak of World War I saw these plans put on hold. In fact, it wasn't until October 1917 that the physicist was able to step up to the role. And by that time, the German Empire was entering its final days. Prior to World War I, the German Empire had been prosperous and influential. Since forming in 1871, it had become one of the world's greatest powers, with a burgeoning economy, an unrivaled army, and its allegiances with both Austro-Hungarian and Ottoman empires painted it as formidable in the eyes of its foes. But despite the advantages at its disposal, the German Empire soon began to suffer as the war took hold. And as hostilities dragged out on the Western Front, many normal citizens found themselves without access to food. Then, in 1917, the Empire made a fatal mistake. The Germans announced they would not be restricting submarine warfare, prompting the United States to enter the fray. And in the spring of 1918, the Empire's last-ditch attempt to conquer the Western Front ended in failure. On November 11, 1918, the war was declared over and a new chapter in Western Europe began. With the collapse of the Austro-Hungarian and Ottoman empires, it became clear that European borders would need to be redefined. Then, in the same month that the war ended, the German Revolution began. By the time it was over, Emperor Wilhelm II had abdicated and a democratic system had been put in place. At this time, much of Europe was in a state of disarray. While borders were hastily redrawn in the aftermath of the war, problems began to emerge with them. For example, in places such as Poland and Czechoslovakia, ethnic groups found that they'd been cut off from their own kin. Perhaps unsurprisingly, these new boundaries caused great unrest. And as new states strove to solidify their identities, many minorities found that their cultures had become problematic, This was the case even within areas where they'd lived their entire lives. According to historians, these prejudices particularly affected the Jewish people. Before this point, the Jews had enjoyed some societal advances under the reign of Franz Joseph I. As emperor of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, Franz Joseph I had declared that a person's religion should not affect their rights. However, after the collapse of the empire, the situation grew bleak once again for many of Europe's Jews. With their unique culture and religious beliefs, they found themselves the target of much discrimination. And although the full horror of Hitler's regime had yet to take hold, anti-Semitic attitudes nonetheless flourished across Germany. It's impossible for us today to gain a true impression of this tumultuous period in history. Yet a recent uncovered letter does offer some insight. The note was written by Albert Einstein in August of 1922, and it reveals what one of the world's smartest men thought of the chaos that had come to surround him. 2 months before the letter was written, German Foreign Minister Walther Rathenau had been assassinated. Having recently championed a treaty to open up opportunities for trade with the Soviet Union, Rathenau was seen by some right-wing groups as a dangerous revolutionary. On June 24th, he was shot and killed by members of the Nationalist Organization Consul, a terrorist body. Apparently, many believe that Rathenau's Jewish background had played a role in his assassination. And Einstein, who'd been a friend of the minister, was told by authorities that he too could be at risk. So the physicist fled his home in Berlin, taking refuge in the north of Germany. That August, Einstein penned the letter to his sister Maria, whom he affectionately referred to as Maja. Though uncertain, it's believed that he wrote the message while living in Kiel, a city in Germany's Baltic coast. Shortly afterwards, he departed for Asia, where he'd spend the next 6 months on a speaking tour. In the letter, Einstein spoke of the rise of anti-Semitism and nationalism that had taken hold in Germany and much of Europe. "Out here, nobody knows where I am, and I'm believed to be missing," he wrote. "Here are brewing economically and politically dark times." Afterwards, Einstein went on to explain that he was happy to have escaped the growing unrest. However, according to expert Ziev Rosenkrantz, he did not see his exile as a permanent solution. Einstein's initial reaction was one of panic and a desire to leave Germany for good, he told the Associated Press in November 2018. Within a week, he had changed his mind. The letter reveals a mindset, rather typical of Einstein, in which he claims to be impervious to external pressures, Rosenkrantz continued. One reason may be to assuage his sister's concerns. Another is that he didn't like to admit that he was stressed about external factors. In fact, Einstein seemed keen to assure Maja that he was safe. "I'm doing pretty well, despite all the anti-Semites among the German colleagues," he wrote. "I'm very reclusive here, without noise and without unpleasant feelings, and I'm earning my money mainly independent of the state, so that I'm really a free man. You see, I'm about to become some kind of itinerant preacher," Einstein continued, referring to his forthcoming speaking tour. "That is, firstly, pleasant, and secondary, necessary." Later in the letter, he again played down the situation. "Don't worry about me," he wrote. "I myself don't worry either. Even if it's not quite kosher, people are very upset." Despite his attempts at positivity, however, Einstein noted that the same problems were also appearing elsewhere. "In Italy, it seems to be at least as bad," he noted. At the time, the National Fascist Party was about to come to power, and the country's soon-to-be leader, Benito Mussolini, was known for his anti-Semitic comments. As the assistant director of the California Institute of Technology's Einstein Papers Project, Ziev Rosenkrantz possesses significant insight into Einstein, and according to him, the letter was not Einstein's first warning with regards to anti-Semitism in Germany. It does, however, represent his feelings during a crucial time in his life. This letter reveals to us the thoughts that were running through Einstein's mind and heart at a very preliminary stage of Nazi terror, explained Marin Ehren from Jerusalem's Kedem Auction House, where the letter was eventually sold. However, it would be a full year before Hitler made his first grab for power, and it would be even longer before the full horror of his ideals would become apparent. On November 8, 1923, Adolf Hitler stormed a beer hall where State Commissioner Gustav von Kahr was giving a speech. With the support of a posse of armed men, Hitler announced that he had deposed the current leaders, and he proclaimed that a new government was about to be formed. Ultimately, Hitler's coup was a failure, and the future dictator spent 8 months in jail. However, the incident had propelled him and his beliefs into the public eye. and in January 1933, he eventually took on the role of Chancellor. Just 2 months later, the Enabling Act gave him almost unlimited powers. Einstein sensed at this time, just as he had in 1922, that trouble was coming. In 1933, he learned that his summer home had been confiscated by Nazis during a trip to the United States. And so he soon traveled to Belgium and immediately surrendered his German citizenship. Einstein sought refuge in the United States at this time, and he was far from the only one looking for safety abroad. In fact, it's thought that more than 300,000 Jews fled Germany between 1933 and 1939. For those that remained, a fate worse than displacement was in store. Just as Einstein had predicted, dark times descended on his homeland. After World War II broke out in September 1939, the Nazi regime enforced increasingly harsh restrictions on the Jewish community. Then in 1942, the deportations to concentration camps began. The Nazis sent millions of Jews to the camps, forcing them into hard labor and often gassing them to death. By the end of World War II, some 6 million had perished. The Jewish population of Europe had shrunk to just a third of what it was before the war. As well as slaughtering the Jewish people, the Nazis also worked to eradicate any influence that they might have had. Even Einstein's work was dismissed under the regime, his theory of relativity dubbed Jewish physics. Even after the war had ended, he did not return to his homeland, eventually dying in New Jersey in 1955. More than 60 years later, Einstein's letter foretelling the horrors of the Holocaust had excited the collecting world. The relationship between Albert and Maja was a very special and close one, which adds another dimension to Einstein the man and greater authenticity to his writings, Marin Ehren explained. On November 12, 2018, the note went to auction, eventually fetching almost $40,000. But 3 weeks later, this record was smashed when another of Einstein's writings sold for a staggering $2.9 million. Known as the God Letter, it deals with his views on religion, making it a fascinating read for those wanting to know more about the great man. Though Einstein did not practice his religion, he was nonetheless a proud member of the Jewish community. However, he was not so proud as to see a difference between the Jewish people or anyone else. "The Jewish people to whom I gladly belong," he wrote, "and in whose mentality I feel profoundly anchored, still for me does not have any different kind of dignity from all other people."